Good morning. Well, before we get started, let's say a few words about safety. Whenever you're testing batteries, there's a small but measurable chance of causing an explosion. What happens is that you create a spark near the battery, and if hydrogen and oxygen gas come together during that spark, that causes an explosion. Of course, the sulfuric acid that's in the battery sprays everywhere, and so it should go without saying that you want to wear safety glasses right through the whole process of testing. And in fact, I'm doing that, but you can't really see it on the tape, so I'm mentioning it now specifically. Now, when you look back in retrospect at those cases, most of the time it was a lead acid battery that for some reason was overcharged, or at least a cell was overcharged. And so that's your warning flag. If you've got a cell that's overcharged or a battery that's got blown out sides, you want to not test that battery and certainly not test it within the confines of a boat. Today it's a rainy, blustery day. It's about 9°C out there. And not the most ideal day to be checking the state of health of your battery system, but I've got some spare time, so I'm going to do that today. I've got three AGM batteries, two of them that are in parallel to represent a house battery, and one which is a starter battery. And over here, I've got a built-in voltmeter. And I'm not sure if you can see it here. There. So what it says is the starter battery is right now 12.9 volts, and the house batteries are at 12.3. And if you look at the amperage from my solar battery charger, I've got 2.5 amps flowing. So for the moment, I'm going to disable the charging system. I'm going to undo this connection here. Of course, the only way to properly test these is to isolate them and do load tests on each of them individually. You can do that with capacitive testers or with a carbon pile load tester. And of course, you want to do that when the ambient temperature is warm and the batteries are all fully charged. And so this is just going to be a screening test today. What I'm going to do first is I'm going to undo the connections here to this one of the two connections on the house battery, and we're going to test that one by itself. Now, this battery is completely isolated.
Now, while we're doing this, let me ask you a question. How does overcharging lead to the formation of hydrogen and oxygen gas?
And here's a look at the solar charger up top. It's nice and clear. I've left the protective matting on it just to try and keep it well protected. Now we're going to do the second battery in the house battery series. And I've allowed the carbon pile tester to cool down a little bit. So here we go. This one seems a little better.
Well, why does an overcharged battery form hydrogen and oxygen gas? Here's the overall equation in a lead acid battery. When the battery is being discharged, the equation goes to the right, and when charging, it goes to the left. During discharge, you can see both the negative pole and the positive poles are being sulfated, and you're replacing sulfuric acid with water. Either way that reaction goes, you're not making any gas, so these equations aren't explaining what's happening. The answer is there's an unwanted side reaction, hydrolysis of water. When you charge a battery, you're providing the energy to turn water into oxygen at the positive pole and hydrogen at the negative pole. The thing that drives this reaction is charging too fast at too high a voltage and charging a flat battery that has a higher concentration of water. That's one of the reasons it's not a good idea to rapidly charge a dead battery with the alternator. It promotes hydrolysis and shortens your battery life. A better way is to trickle charge it slowly over the course of a few days. To replace that lost water in an old-style lead-acid battery, you remove the caps and top up each cell with distilled water. Technically, you're supposed to do that after charging because the bubbling water can pop off the caps and make a mess. But most batteries these days are sealed, and AGM batteries are never refillable. For safety, AGM batteries use a one-way valve to vent gas when internal pressure reaches a set limit. If that vent fails to open, you can get a bulging sidewall of a battery. It's not usually as dramatic as this, but you need to look for it. The other thing causing a bulging sidewall is a frozen battery, and it is noteworthy that a discharged battery is much more vulnerable to freezing.
And finally, let's do the starter motor, the starter battery. That's not really hooked up to anything at the moment, so we're just going to put it under load test. Yeah,
11.0. So the starter is the best of the three, and the weakest is the one on the far left. So I'm going to take the one on the far left home.
Now, even though hydrogen gas is very different than propane in that it's very light and unlikely to stay in a confined area for very long, some would argue that we shouldn't do testing within the small confines of a boat. And I get that. I think that if you're at all concerned about especially overcharging in your batteries, then a safer approach would be to pull the batteries right out of the boat and do the testing in some well-ventilated area. But I think the way I did it is pretty safe. Overall, I used a method that caused minimal sparking. I was wearing my safety glasses and really haven't had a problem doing it the way I have. But if you're concerned about that, then take the batteries out and test them in a better ventilated area.
Now, I've fully charged the battery here in the garage for a few days, actually. And I took it off the charger last night to see if it would hold a charge overnight. And it's been about 18 hours since I did that. And you can see our base charge now without putting the tester on is about 12.7 volts. Let's see what happens when we put it under a test now. So we'll again go for 15 seconds.
Well, let's talk about the load testers I use regularly. This one here is for disposable batteries. It's 1.5 or 9 volt or whatever. This thing is great, and you end up saving money because you end up throwing away fewer batteries. These other two, they call them toasters, and it's because they heat up like a toaster and you have to let them cool down between tests. This is the one I showed in the boat. It's a little underpowered. It draws about 80 amps, which is a little low for accurate testing, but I find it works surprisingly well, and it's very inexpensive, the least expensive of all of these. Now, the conventional technique with lead acid batteries and these carbon pile testers is to divide the label of the battery, the label showing cold cranking amps, divide that in half, and that's the amperage that you test at. This unit's capable of 500 amps, and you can adjust the amperage by adjusting resistance here and reading amperage to get the current that you want. And then after 15 seconds, the device beeps and you read the voltage at 15 seconds.
Well, for years everywhere, shops were looking for a way to simplify and automate the process. What they really wanted was a way to test partially charged batteries and a way to test batteries within a large bank without interrupting service.
This led to the recognition that if you apply a defined frequency of AC voltage through a capacitor to a battery, you could measure AC current and voltage and from that calculate impedance. It turned out that both impedance and what some companies are defining as conductance correlated well with the carbon pile resistance method that I'm using here. From there, industry spawned a whole generation of digital voltage storage devices that have taken over the market, mainly because it saves the technician time. The best devices adjust their protocol based on ambient temperature and device and battery, because temperature and those other factors have a major effect on results. Of course, the downside was the major variance in how different batteries and different testers performed. This means you need to know and trust your tool, and you want to plot results over time and test regularly. It is noteworthy that when electronic testing is equivocal, it's advised to go right back to resistance testing the way we did it anyway.
Now, I don't use a digital electronic tester because I'm not convinced that the inexpensive devices are more accurate than what I already have, and because the expensive devices that I'd like to have are outside of my price range. Let's go on and test this second battery with a high amperage load test. And we've got our resting voltage is about 12.8 volts. And so now let's turn up the juice. And so you want about half the cold cranking amps. These are typically in the range of 500 cold cranking amps. And so around 250 is about right. The other formula, if you don't have that, and I don't have that on this battery, is three times the amp hours. And there we are. And so it's 8.7. Well, where are we at? The reason I tested this weakest battery first is I wanted to make sure it wasn't a drain on its partners on the other two. That is there a slow short to ground in this battery that's pulling the voltage of the other two down and not allowing the other two to achieve a full state of charge? And so I bought the battery home. I warmed it up and I recharged it. If it had been an aqueous lead acid battery, I would have recharged it with distilled water, but it wasn't, so I didn't need to do that step. And then I went on to test it. And I turned the charger off for 24 hours, and it's held its state of charge. So there's no clear evidence of a short to ground so far. And then I went on to test it, and I tested at 80 amps and it passed, but it failed at 300 amps. Now, is that a valid test? Well, my garage is not a heated garage, so we're not at 20 degrees C, and I guessed at cold cranking amps at 600. If I'd guessed a little high, then the testing again gives numbers a little lower, and so I'm not completely certain that this test represents a fail in my situation. Now, this battery is not being used as a starter motor. I think if it were being used on a starter motor, it would be still a clear fail, but it's not. It's being used for reserve, and reserve is the holy grail of battery testing. Here's a plot showing reserve against conductance with the new battery testers, and you can see it's more of a scattergram. It's not clearly a linear association, and so I'm reluctant to call this one a fail. What's my end conclusion? I'm going to conclude that this battery is on probation. It hasn't been cut from the team yet. We're going to retest it in a few months' time, and truthfully, I think that this battery is on its way out in the next year or two, but I'm not going to toss it right now. Let's go on to get the second battery, and we'll test that one. Well, this morning I went to the boat, and I took that other battery back, and I hooked it up to the bilge pump, and then I brought this battery back to the garage, and I'm going to warm it up and charge it overnight. Now, I thought I'd show you the charges that I've been using. This charger here is the charger I've had for the longest. I've had it for about 20 years, and it has served me well. Occasionally, it's let me down in the sense that if a battery is too flat, it won't recognize it as a battery and won't charge it. And if that happens, you have to hook it up to a second battery, try and get that charge up enough that the battery charger will recognize it as an appropriate battery that's hooked up right, and it'll charge it for you. Through the years, there's been a significant evolution towards less and less hardware and more technology, and both of these are programmable chargers. This is the one I'm going to use today, and in fact I've hooked it up already. The more modern chargers are programmable, and they can analyze the circuit and analyze the battery for you, and so to do a hard battery test isn't necessary if you've got one of these kind of battery chargers. These ones have a desulfation mode where it gives an intermittent pulse of current to the battery to try and desulfate the plates, and that hopefully will give you a little bit more life in the battery. And they have different modes that you can use depending on the kind of battery that you have. I've got it set up for this AGM battery that we're going to charge today. It also has a reconditioning mode if you want to use it, although looking through the manual, it didn't say that reconditioning was a safe effort in an AGM battery, so I'm not going to do that. So tomorrow, we're going to have a look at this, and we'll see if we get a green light at the end of it. If we get a green light, then according to this battery charger, the battery is good.
I should say a few words about the ways you can be misled when you think one of your batteries has failed. The common causes of confusion are poor connections, parasitic drain, and inadequate charging before testing. Every few years we read about sting investigations done by journalists who send a car in with one of these three problems. It's embarrassing how often professionals miss the diagnosis and sell the client a new battery. Before you go to a store for free testing, you want to be sure the battery is warm and fully charged, or you'll set up those techs for making a wrong diagnosis. Now, poor connections are easy to inspect and clean, but don't forget to look at the ground cable connection to the engine. Parasitic drain is a phenomenon causing depletion of the battery from some secondary device like a bilge pump or even another battery. In the boat, if you leave the master switch turned off, then devices downstream of the master won't cause a problem. But you may be surprised to learn how many devices on a boat are connected independent of the master switch. Now the way around that is to take the battery home, warm it up, and if it's a refillable aqueous lead acid battery, then top up the electrolyte in each cell with distilled water. Then trickle charge it overnight and test objectively in the morning. If it passes, then you'll need to go back and look again for poor connections or parasitic drain.
Well, here we are after 24 hours, and you can see that the program itself has given us a green light saying that the battery seems to be good. Now I'm not sure how long the analysis phase lasts here, and I do have time to do a manual analysis myself, and so what I'm going to do today is I'm going to take the leads off, and we'll give it 24 hours and see if it holds a charge over that time.
Well, it's still pouring rain out there. The next step is to go out to the boat and check the starter motor in isolation, and I'm going to do that later today, but there's no need for me to drag you along to do that because I think it'll be unremarkable. What have we done? We've tested each individual battery in isolation. We've proven that none is acting like a drain on the others. We've also got objective data using different measuring techniques to test the battery and see what each battery can put out, and that'll be useful for the future for a comparison. In particular, AGM batteries are hard to assess, and by having an objective baseline with which to compare is going to be useful. In my experience, when batteries fail, they do fail in a fairly dramatic fashion, and so
Quite often you don't need complicated testing maneuvers to decide that a battery is bad. Which of the three testers is better? I'll leave that with you. I think for a starter motor you want something that's high amperage. But for the AGM batteries that are used as house batteries, honestly I think any of the three would work. And so I'll leave that with you. So if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, then hit like or subscribe or leave a comment. I'd love to hear what others say. Thanks for watching.